Africa to You at the Global Health Catalyst Summit. And with me right now is Ambassador Brylyne from the Pan-African Parliament, and she's the Ambassador for Food Security. Welcome to Africa to You.
Thank you very much. And indeed, you're correct, the Ambassador for Food Security in Africa.
She is a phenomenal woman for some of us who have heard her speak before or earlier. What is your role at the Global Health Catalyst Summit, and why is it important to you to be here today?
It's very important from so many different perspectives. My background is medical, and as I said earlier, I'm actually a commercial farmer, and linking global health and food security with all the micronutrients, I mean, there's no better pairing of those two. You can't separate them.
And, you know, earlier I heard you talk about why it is important to be careful and watchful about the food we eat. Can you tell us a little bit more about that?
Well, it's very important because we're talking about the rise of these cancers on the globe, and we should also be addressing why is it so now? Is it because of what we're doing, or is it because of what we are not doing? Are we using the right pesticides, or are we not using the right pesticides, or are we contaminating the environment, the soils that we need to grow our food with other radioactive materials or medical waste, or do we have heavy metals? What have we got in our soils now? What is happening? Has there been mutation, or have we changed, or has something changed? So through platforms like this, no doubt that we're going to actually come up with answers, because on my part, I just feel that when we talk about food security, we can't talk about it without talking about the importance of micronutrients. And as you know, most of the people at hospitals, queuing up at hospitals, they're malnourished. If you give them just a good diet, and you find that a lot of the complaints that they come with, those are dispelled immediately. So you can reduce the health budget as well. So I've been asking for governments to pump more money into agriculture and investing in the youngsters as well.
Yeah, it's interesting that you talk about that, because when I look at the indigenous ways of life in at least the African communities, they are mostly affected by the new, whether they're pesticides that are being introduced to these communities. And I'll give you an example. I was born in southwestern Uganda among the Bachiga. When they were cultivating, if it was beans, they would put the seeds in the mouth, peed them in as they dug the holes. And then the question is now, if those beans have been sprayed, what happens to those communities? Of course, if they are still practicing the indigenous ways of cultivation, but with modern pesticides, and you know, to preserve the seeds, and which again brings me to the question: these rural communities are the most affected when it comes to the healthcare disparity. What would you recommend in terms of bridging the healthcare gap?
Education, and information. How much information are we giving to our rural poor? Are we communicating the messages to the rural poor? You're right by saying putting it in the mouth. What is, you don't know what those seeds have been coated with, and is there the right information that you're giving to people to tell them that it is no longer the same practices? It leads us to the question of climate change. Remember, our elders, the first drop of rains means prepare your land, second drop, get ready, third drop, plant your seed. But it's no longer the case now. It floods, or there's drought. So you're now talking about drought resistant crops and so forth. But then again, the importance of education. And that's why I've been advocating for the youngsters, that it's very important to take education to the youngsters, because at the end of the day, they're the ones who are going to save this whole planet from the mess that we're in, whether health issues or whether food issues, whatever we can talk about. We're running out of space because the population is increasing every day. So we're going to have to adapt smart ways of farming. And of course, just giving the right information to people. And also, why is whatever is caught in the seeds harmful to us? What have they caught it with? Should we also not be having a discussion with those companies that we can now start to see what is it that they're using, and why is it so strong that it will end up giving health issues?
Right, which again brings me to one of my favorite conversations, which is promoting ethnomedicine as a way to intervene, you know, in these healthcare disparities. We all know that the majority, over 80% of rural communities, the primary healthcare is mostly indigenous healthcare practices. So, as a Pan-Africanist and as an ambassador, what is being done on the continent to tap into the ethnomedicine?
Well, I agree with you 100%. And one of the things that I've done now, we've now signed a collaboration with Harvard, Stellenbosch, Heidelberg, America State University, and University of Pennsylvania. I've allocated about 100 hectares of my own personal farm land to put up a center, a phytomedicine center. And we've already mapped about 2,000 of these indigenous plants. And let's extrapolate the chemical ingredient and also the active ingredient. Who says we need a whole bucket of the leaves? Perhaps we only need a teaspoon. So why is nobody doing it for us? But as Africans, if we don't stand up and look into it ourselves as Africans and take ownership of Africa, nobody else will. You think the big companies, I'm sorry to say, I mean, they're not interested in researching it for us. So it's up to us to research. And we know these herbs work. We know because then our ancestors or forefathers, this is what they lived on, and they have a toothache, they have a root of a tree, they just chew that root of a tree. But then is this root of a tree the same one that they used 50-60 years ago? Has there been mutation? Is it more potent now? Is it more poisonous, or is it working better, or have we changed on our genetics? Has it changed ourselves? So it's about research. If we do research, then surely we can come up with something that is exciting, and I'm looking forward to it myself, because then as a scientist as well, I think it's one of those most important things that we need to do. Who knows, maybe we can actually come up with something that will discover or decode something that will help us and then just have a better health for everybody, and cheaper as well, because then these plants are found everywhere. But then again, then we talk about deforestation. Are we educating the people in the rural poor? Maybe they're destroying a lot of those plants, and now there's one that looks similar, and this one that looks similar to the one that was there before is the one that causes cancer, but we don't know until we research. So that's why it's important to involve them as well. So community centers and hubs and facilitators to actually facilitate, you know, operationalize the plethora of these policies that government set, and then get people to understand more about what is in the environment, bring the people on board, get them involved, bring the traditional healers. It works. There's some people who just live on that and it works. The people will have like a cancer on the leg, and they go to the traditional healers and they'll tell you, oh, you asked me to burn this ashes, and I put the ash, and after 3 days it healed. And it does heal. But after all, where do all these synthetic ones come from? Don't they derive them from plants? They do get them from plants, and of course they put other things for coating them and everything, but I think we should really explore the traditional herbs. I really agree with you 100%, and for me, I'm going to put a lot of effort into that.
It's great to learn to hear that, because actually last summer I was in Uganda, and I learned that there was a team of doctors who is working with the herbal medicine group. So the medical doctors diagnose the patients, and then under the supervision of the doctors, the herbalists administer the medication, you know, that is, and it's moderated, the dosages are moderated by the medical doctors, and then they leave the patients in a room under observation until they're well off. But then, of course, the question is, you know, I've heard, though, that many of the medicinal plants are patented by foreign entities. How true is that?
Well, like anything else. Like anything else, if somebody comes up with an idea, and if they don't have the resources to take it to the next level, someone else grabs it and they take it and they run with it. But a lot of these things work, and I just only wish that we could get more research into it. And I'm happy that the likes of Harvard, they're coming on board now to look at all this. The session on Sunday is going to be very exciting. It's all on phytomedicines and also the use of cannabis. And I know there's a buzz about cannabis, but who says when we start doing research, we might actually stumble across something even better than cannabis? Who knows? So without research, there's not much that we can talk about. Right. We need to do research so that we see, let's put the value in these traditional herbs. Let's put them in capsules. Let's put them into creams. Let's put them into whatever format. Who says you need a whole bucket? Maybe you only need a teaspoon. Maybe it's only like the little tip of the leaf that you only need. Maybe it's just the root. Because I believe that there's not a single plant that God puts in this universe that does not have medicinal properties. I strongly believe every single plant, God put it for a reason. But because we have not taken time to actually go that route, maybe that's all that we need.
Thank you for sharing your wisdom with us. And keep us posted. I will be knocking at your door asking you what progress you've made.
Thank you very much. And of course, just a big thank you to media, because I always say we need media. We need you. You make us or you break us. So the only way for you to actually get some of these things, especially when you're talking about these phytomedicines, I'm just so excited that it's also a topic close to your heart. And I think together we can do much, much more. And let's take it to the schools. Let's educate our little ones, because at the end of the day, the five-year-olds of today, they are the future. Let them grow up knowing that we need to do more smart farming, smart this, smart everything, and explore all these things. We're talking about cancer, but we're using big words. But now let's try and see the language that people understand in education. And then let's not forget the culture and the religion and the beliefs of people. So it's very important to also address those issues. It's really important. But thank you very much for having me on your program.
Thank you for your time, and see you next time.